Belinda Audiobooks presents this unabridged recording of The Devil Latch, written by Sonya Hartnett and read by Caroline Lee. Be sure to visit our website at www.belinda.com. The dedication reads, "For John." It is easy, terribly easy, to shake a man's faith in himself. To take advantage of that, to break a man's spirit, is devil's work. George Bernard Shaw, Candida. Part 1. On the roof of the garden shed, two insects are fighting to the death. One, a wasp, will win. The other, a mantis, knows it will lose. A dusty privet shields the shed from the afternoon sun. It is March, and the weather is fine. Kitten Latch lies in the shade, scratching idly at the rust in the corrugated iron. In his head, the demons turn over the things they know. The mantis goes by many names. Soothsayer, mule killer, the devil's riding horse. It is a carnivorous creature, its front prayerful legs aligned with spikes to stab and secure the source of its food. The mantis is the only insect that can turn its head from side to side. It can be brown, but more usually, it is green. Wasps, too, are carnivorous, although some will also eat overripe vegetable matter. The wasp has a sting, which it uses to defend itself and to attack its prey. Wasp venom dissolves red blood cells. A wasp can choose to sting its prey through the nervous system, which leaves the victim alive but helpless. Such conquests are then transported to the nest to provide food for the young wasps, which are wholly carnivorous. Kitten props his chin on his hands. The wasp is a swarming insect, and it swarms over the mantis. Its assault remains urgent even after the mantis has weakened and ceased to defend itself. And Kitten feels the beat of teardrop wings against his face, hears the furious buzz. He hears, too, the noises coming from the house next door, but he does not bother to look up. The wasp begins to disassemble the mantis before the defeated is dead. A wasp likes warm weather and hates the rain. It is also surprisingly finicky in its tastes. If its meal is a blowfly, it will sever the head, wings and legs, and leave them where they lie, flying off with only the chubby torso. Kitten is interested and surprised then when the wasp clips through the mantis's narrow waist and hoists the front half of the body into the air, taking what he had expected it to discard. Do the wings and legs and head of a mantis taste different then from those of a fly? The remaining half writhes briefly, showing the pale belly to the sky. The wasp, clumsy with its angular load, is not difficult for Kitten to catch and crush under his hand. Predator and prey are left as one against the peeling paint. Kitten yawns and rubs at his eyes. In his head, the demons are restless and kick at their confines like cramped twins in a womb. They are, in fact, twins, although the colour of one is black and the other blazing red. They are naked in there, but armed with sharp teeth and the vilest of tempers. The arrival of the people next door has made them curious and angry, so they twist and twist and twist, giving Kitten no peace. He sits up, cleans his hand of the wasp remains, and leaps from the roof of the garden shed. Agatha is in the kitchen, standing at the sink. From here, she has watched Kitten through the window, although she could not see what had held his interest so long. She watches him cross the garden, keeping always to the path, sees him wipe his feet against the mat and step into the house. She has known him since he was little, and she takes care of him, as she takes care of Kitten's grandfather, Paul. She offers him a cup of tea, but he does not even glance at her. He is making for his grandfather's bedroom, and she takes the kettle from the stove, extinguishes the flame. The grandfather swivels his eyes when Kitten enters the room. Kitten crosses the floor and pulls the curtains, and the room is filled with the white afternoon light. The old man gags and splutters and screws shut his eyes. He cannot turn his head away, for the creeping stiffness has recently reached his neck. He is hardening, like a plant, from the roots up. Kitten nods at the view, which his grandfather cannot see. "We have," he says, "new neighbours." "Isn't that nice?" The old man makes a crackling noise in his throat, and Kitten casts him a quick and benevolent smile. "They've been shifting in all day," he says, and returns his gaze to the front garden. "A young man and a young woman. Living in sin, I suppose." His grandfather makes a barking sound, not, Kitten knows, the sound for old-fashioned beliefs, or the sound for old-fashioned beliefs being mocked, but the sound that is all that remains of the old man's once formidable rage. He wants to protest Kitten's invasion of the room, the drawing of the curtains, the letting in of the light. Kitten smiles vaguely, as if he understands nothing of this, and leans his weight against the sill. "They have brought a lot of things with them," he explains. "They have boxes and boxes. They have a cat, and the cat was also in a box. It wasn't a good box, and the cat escaped. It is a grey cat, and it moved very fast. Ptolemy is what its name is. The girl called, 'Ptolemy, Ptolemy,' as she ran after it." He glances over his shoulder to make sure the old man is listening. His grandfather's body is an angular, narrow ridge under the covers of the bed. He is watching Kitten closely, and his clenched teeth are showing. In the sunlight, his lips glisten damply, and the dust shows itself on the furniture. Kitten looks beyond the window. "The cat ran across the garden and leaped up and over the fence. It was in our garden then, but it did not know it. It simply ran and ran. And it was running for our back fence, running for its life, and that's when it saw Cocky, and Cocky saw it, and Cocky screeched. Did you hear him? And the cat stopped in its tracks and fuzzed itself up. Perhaps it has never seen a thing such as Cocky. He certainly is a sight." The old man is listening now, and his fury at his grandson has died down, for Cocky is the only thing he loves, and he concentrates his energy into hearing the story. "Cat looks at Cocky. Cocky looks at Cat. Ptolemy, a king, an idiot cat." Kitten sighs and shrugs as if he has grown bored with telling the tale. He has big eyes that are coloured a foolish blue, and he turns and blinks them at his grandfather. The old man waits, and waits longer, and finally he cannot stand the sight and is moved to hiss, "Bastard!" The twins in Kitten's head open their eyes. "Bastard! Bastard!" "What is that you're saying, Paulie?" "Vicious bastard!" spits Paul Latch. Kitten laughs. He takes a cigarette from his pocket and lights it. "You have such a very black heart," he says. The old man does not realize that each hateful word makes Kitten stronger. Kitten blows smoke across the room and looks again out the window. "And then," he says, "the girl climbed the fence. She climbed it and jumped to the ground and looked around our garden. 'Ptolemy,' she whispered. 'Ptolemy, come here.' She kept very low to the earth, as if that would hide her, and she moved very slowly, as if this is what Cat preferred. But Cat did not hear her. Cat was looking at Cocky. So she was able to pick Cat up and carry him away, stroking his head, calling him bad. All this I saw, but she did not see me. I know what she is called. She is Amy. The young man is Curtis. I have watched them all day. I know what their furniture looks like, and I know the clothes they wear. I know the paintings that will hang on their walls and the plates from which they'll eat their meals. I know their house better than they do. I know the boards that creak and the tiles that are loose. I know how tightly to turn off the taps. I know each flower in their garden and each stone in their driveway. I know the size and shape of the rooms, and I know the windows that will let you in and out." Kitten stops and contemplates the ash gathered at the tip of his cigarette. The old man is eyeing him, but his gaze soon falls to what his grandchild sees. The ash clings delicately to the red coal, held together by its own design. Kitten looks at the carpet on which the ash will drop, holding its cylindrical shape all the way down until the shattering instant when it hits the floor. It will need only one dab with his bare toes to make it impossible to clean away. The old man will never see it, but his knowledge of the dirty patch will eat at him. Paul Latcher's eyes are bulging. Inside Kitten's head, the demons turn and turn. Kitten lets the moment hold. Then he opens his free hand and taps the ash into his palm. "Do you know what I think?" he asks his grandfather. "I think our Ptolemy will be back." A soft moaning comes from the old man. In his bed, he lies prone. He will never move, but the sound says everything he would like to do, tells everything he remembers he could do. How he longs to crush Kitten like a bug. Kitten considers him for a moment, letting the cigarette burn. Then he walks away from the window and stops beside the bed and stares down at his grandfather. "There's no cause to whimper," he says. "You needn't think these new people will distract me. I will never leave you. I am your familiar. I'm here to help." "Kitten," says Agatha. And Kitten lifts his head. To look at him, caught by surprise as he is, she can scarcely believe in his wicked soul. She has stood beyond the doorway and heard every taunting thing he has said, but the face he lifts to her is that of an angel, with the softest, whitest locks, the unflawed flesh of a child, an expression that is guileless. But is not beauty the perfect disguise? Why, she thinks, would a devil be anything but beautiful? "Kitten," she says sharply, being hard on him. "Kitten, you know you're not to smoke in here. Take it out. Take yourself out into the nice day." He looks contrite and slinks from the room, batting his lashes as he passes her. When she hears him swing the fly screen, she goes to the bed and fusses with the covers, although they need no adjusting, for Paul makes no move to disturb them. The old man says nothing and does not look at her. They are both thinking, a familiar is a creature that attends the evil. The houses in this street are dark and heavy, for they were built in dark and heavy times, when eldest sons were fighting wars. They are built low, and many are kept neat by widows and widowers, for it is a neighbourhood where death creeps about in the night, gently dispatching the elderly occupants. The gardens are large and unadventurous. Here and there is a failed native garden, but most of the plants are English trees and shrubs. The neighbours know each other and have done so for years, but they do not collect on corners to chat. Their friendliness rarely extends beyond a genial nod of the head.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.